So essentially here I want to, very briefly, because you know I have just 15 minutes to introduce you, a bit of a project that we started, let's say, a couple of years ago, when I joined back University of Venice, that is LISA. But before telling you what is LISA, I want to tell you what are the goals of LISA. Nothing, I would say, especially particularly new or exciting, but the idea is that we started to implement a library, Library for Static Analysis, that's the acronym, LISA, and we want to provide a free, open source, and so on, implementation of all the standard components that you need to implement when you want to build up a static analyzer. Okay, in my experience, I guess also in Francesco's experience, you have to spend quite a lot of time often implementing the base components that Patrick and Radia formalized in their first own papers. So of course, here, just a couple of examples, lattice structure, fixed point computations, but then you go ahead based on the different domains, you often you need a non-relational numerical domain, other type of abstraction, and so on and so forth. So we started this project, say, okay, we want to have some basis in order to get all these together. We want to have this, let's say, understandable, easy to use to, let's say, common people. Well, of course, common people often are people with a PhD in the topic that are not so common. So we started this project with the first goal to build up something that is easy to use. So everything I will show you is implemented in Java, hopefully. I don't find it so hard, at least less hard than C++, for instance, but anyway, a very common and popular programming language. And we implemented there all, let's say, the main components of this static analysis. And in particular, up to now, we focused quite a lot on using LISA for teaching purposes. So here at the University of Venice, we have, in particular, this one course taught by Cortesi on static analysis based on absence interpretation, let's say, despite the name, the exact name of the course. And there we are using this kind of library in order to allow our students to build up some very simple analysis, let's say, you know, data flow analysis, available expressions, that kind of things that if you have a good framework behind, you just need to write, let's say, snippet of course, okay, to implement it. So, you know, even the students can just focus on the few critical details of the analysis. On the other hand, we want also to have something that is expressive and extensible in the sense that we want to use it for, you know, our scientific papers. You know, when you write down a scientific paper, you have the theory, you think about the problems, and then you want to have some experimentation. And that's the second step. And the third and ideal step, so you can see here, there are people smiling and not, so the last one is not yet there. We would like to build up something that becomes, let's say, actively maintained. And of course, being actively maintained means you should be able at some point in the future to have kind of a community, being able to use it and maybe, you know, add feature, keep it at the pace in the sense that, you know, for instance, Java evolves, so you have something written now in Java 8, Java 9, 11, 17. You need to keep up the pace of what you have done. So the rest of this talk will be focused mostly on the first part. So I wanted to briefly introduce you what is this LISA. Okay, in particular, let's see, maybe I can also open it. Let's give it a try. If it works, I didn't try because, of course, this is not my laptop. So you can access LISA after today's workshop, so probably tomorrow, the day after, we will publish some slides on the web page, so we will find the slides and all the URLs there. So we will build up a GitHub repository, so it's open source, oops, it's public, you can find everything here, it's distributed with the MIT license, so essentially, as I said, we want that this is used and maintained and so on. So it's completely open and you can play, check it, and use it. The idea is to have it based on an extensible representation of control flow graphs, okay? So let's start, let's say, for the beginning. I'm going to show you a bit about the infrastructure that we have in LISA. So first of all, in order to represent the let's say code we are analyzing, we have base class that is a statement. And the statements, of course, it's aimed at representing, let's say, any kind of statement. Inside LISA, you find already some definitions, okay? So in particular, we have statements that, or they do nothing, nope, or they, let's say, cut the sequential flow of execution like return with or without a value or throwing an exception. And then we define the subclass expression, okay, that are statements that they produce a value, okay. And here we have a bunch of different expressions where it might be unary binary expressions, rather than, and this is the critical part, let's say call, okay, calling other methods, calling native function, calling other things. And then, of course, inside the expressions we have also constant values and variables. This is the way in which essentially we represent the base syntax of the program we want to analyze. And these are the components that are inside the nodes of our control flow graph. So our control flow graph will be a graph where we have statements as nodes, and then as edges, we have sequential edges rather than conditional edges. If the expression is validated to true or to false, you jump from one to the other node of the control flow graph. Statements are not interpreted, understood by the analysis. So the abstract domain does not work in terms of statements, because the idea is that statements are extensible. So today I analyze a programming language, I want to add the support for another one. Let's say I'm analyzing Java, now I want to add C or C++. I need to add, I don't know, malloc, I need to add the referencing arbitrary pointer arithmetic, and so on and so forth. I want to add the statements. So I can add the statements there, and then we translate the semantics of the statements, translate them into components that are symbolic expressions. And these symbolic expressions are the components that are fed to the abstract domain. So the abstract domain needs to be able to understand this kind of language. So we call it, let's say, an internal extensible language, because, of course, you know, you introduce some statements that cannot yet be represented with symbolic expression. We have, probably, the developer of this new language, of this new support, will need to add something more. Also, you know, something that at syntactic level might be the same might have a different meaning. Let's say that you are taking A plus B, then if A and B are two numbers, okay, it's numerical addition. If they are two string values, then it's string concatenation. For instance, in Java, with static typing, you already know these two cases, and then you can translate a statement into the appropriate symbolic expression. And then, okay, so all this goes through a semantics method defined on the statement class. Inside the semantic expression world, we divided it in two main components, heap and value, okay? With the idea of saying, okay, everything that is an heap abstraction in some way, in heap expression, in some ways it manages, it deals with the heap. So as you can see here, I'm just representing the core classes that we have. But essentially, you know, I can access something inside the heap, I can alloc some portions of the heap, or I can take a heap reference. And then, as another word, we have value expression, okay? And then, the examples I was giving before, A plus B, so binary expression, ternary expressions, rather than identifiers. And when we talk about identifiers, can be value identifiers or heap identifiers. So I might access a child, get a heap identifier representing that access to the heap, and then, I don't know, assigning a value to that. In that case, we represent this as a heap identifier. And then, of course, we have constants and, you know, other, let's say, standard statements. Then how we build up the analysis state, so you can already imagine, I started with this symbolic expression split in two, so we have an abstract state in which we clearly divide the value and the heap domain. They have a way to communicate that essentially is based on some previous work I did and published at VMKI 2014, I think, okay, and in theoretical computer science, that allow the two to, in some ways, communicate. In particular, if you are an expert about shape analysis, in particular when you know you merge, join, or you instantiate new nodes inside your heap graph. We have an expression stack, so as I said, when we evaluate one of the expressions, we get also expression, and we have also method calls. And then we have an interprocedural analysis, not going into much of the detail. This is a third component on which we have been working a bit. So we can have an interprocedural analysis based on the call graph, okay? Different types of call graph, rapid type rather than class hierarchy, rather than other things. Or one might extend, we have not yet there, it to have an analysis that is based on, I don't know, summaries like what Francesco was showing before, rather than other other approach. By the way, in all the slides you see here up a link. As I said, we are going to publish these slides, so later on you can just click on these links and you can see in the GitHub repository all the components, where they are and how they are implemented. Inside the different domains we have also some implementation of standard components. So we defined, of course, a lattice structure, okay, that is kind of the Java translation of what a lattice is, and also a semantic domain, where the semantic domain is aimed at defining the very minimal operations we need to define a semantic analysis. So far, the main four methods that we expose are, okay, I need to assign some values, I need to perform a small step semantics of some expressions. Okay, so for instance, we might have an active call where the semantic is manually defined, so we can use this type of things, in particular this type of symbolic expression, in order to represent that semantics. And then we can check if an expression is satisfied in order to check some properties. Rather, than we can assume that some conditional expression holds, some conditions hold. And then based on this, we defined and we implemented a bunch of different numerical domains, the standard one, okay, like, you know, functional domain, non-relational domains, rather than standard set, inverse set, and some data flow analysis, in order to get, let's say, a complete framework in order to reach that easy to use ideal goal that we are looking for. Something I didn't say so far, anything I didn't say, what kind of programming language do you support? Well, Lisa works here at the level of control flow graph. We defined and we are using the concept of front end, nothing particular. Essentially, the front end takes a piece of text that is a program written in some programming language, and it translates it to control flow graphs. Okay, so what happens, of course, is that when you define the front end, for now we have been working on the Go programming language. I will tell you something very shortly later, and we are starting to work on Python for the things that also Caterina was showing. When you define your front end, of course, you will need also to define new type of statements, of symbolic expression, and so on, so to represent the peculiarity of that programming language. What I want to point out is that inside Lisa, we put there a front end for a very, very minimal IMP programming language. It's a standard IMP programming language with the flavor of object-oriented features, nothing else. Always with the same idea of saying, okay, we have a small software packet library that allows us to run this analysis. So at least we can write some code, some analysis, and see the results inside Lisa without the need to write, for instance, I don't know, a full Python program or other things. That's the overall architecture. I think so far you should have already a taste about what it looks like. But of course, we start from programs. We translate it to control flow graphs. And then, okay, we compute the fixed point, of course, based on the interprocedural analysis that we defined, in case it uses a call graph, also with the call graphs, using the statement semantics and the analysis state that we defined. Of course, the analysis is parameterized on all these components. So when we start the analysis, we have to say what kind of heap domain we want to use, value domain, and also what type of interprocedural analysis. We can also define some types of some property checkers in order just to produce warnings, or we can just inspect the results. So at the end, we have an analysis dump that shows a graph, so shows on the control flow graph the pre and post state of the results of our analysis. As I was saying, we are, let's say, developing this library and we want to be quite open, so you can find all the versions that we have published so far, all beta versions, so we are not yet confident enough to release a 1.0 version, but they are all in GitHub, and also we have a Maven repository. So if you want to develop your own analysis in Java, you can just create a dependency, I don't know, using Gradle, Maven, and so on, and just say, I depend on Lisa beta 5, 1 beta 5, and you will get all the code already compiled, the bytecode already compiled, and you can use it. And as I was saying, we are not working only on the core Lisa, but also on the Python and the Go project. As I was saying, of course, this is for now just a project that we are mostly carrying on here at the University of Venice. Here, of course, it's also a thank you slide in the sense that the project, as you can see from the numbers, has been carried on mostly by Luca Negrini, that is a PhD student with us that took care of the most part of all the infrastructure of LISA. Then Vincenzo did also quite some work both on the core part and on the analysis of the Go programming languages. And yeah, that's my contribution, apart from the overall ideas and big level ideas. So far, we applied it for the static analysis of smart contracts written in the Go programming language for the Cosmos platform. In particular, we focused on a couple of properties, overflow and non-determinism. And we just published an experience report about using it at the SOAP this year. So it's kind of bugs that we found using it with an industrial partner that we have for this project. We're working in essentially what Caterina said, so to analyze Jupyter notebooks, and we're extending it into many directions. So the idea is also to use it to analyze some robotic software, in case also for some string value analysis and much more. Okay, as I was saying, also important is the teaching experience. One was the one that I told you about, the course at the master level. We adopted it also for a PhD course. All this also reported on another very, let's say, an experience report that we published last year at SOAP. And I would say that's all. And if you want to know more, just drop us an email. We are really looking forward about having people using LISA and giving us feedback and criticism about LISA in order to improve it and, you know, extend its features. Thank you. I'm a bit late, but not so much.
Thank you, Pietro. Any fast question? Yeah.
How did the students like using LISA in teaching? Did they find that they got out something out of it? I'm curious. It would be very useful for having such a tool to hand to the students.
I would say a problem that often you have when you teach abstract interpretation, and I think Patrick is pretty aware about that, is that students get scared by mathematical formulas. So having a tool that... Okay, I'm not sharing anymore the screen, sorry. I wanted just to show you. Having a tool that you can implement a sign domain, this is minimal things, but essentially this is, a very... is sign domain quite simpler than what Patrick showed us, just with the three values, in which you can define what is an addition in few code lines. I would say that at least they can try something, even if they don't like it, they don't understand much about the math behind it. We have seen that this attracts quite a lot, let's say, the average or low student. Of course, for good students, they care more about often mathematical formulas than implementation. But these are usually, you know, the minority of the students that attend these kind of courses.
Okay. So let's think again. No, there was... Oh, sorry. Sorry.
It's more technical. If I change my compiler interface from a control flow graph to SSA, single, can I still use your library? Without losing information coming from SSA?
Good question, and there is some work to do, let's say. Okay. We have not yet investigated. For now, we are really sticking at the control flow graph level also because, as I said, it's something that the student can see. It really matches the IMP language or also the Python program you might write and analyze. So we found it intuitive and good. But we didn't investigate yet, these kind of things for now.
Okay. So let's thank again Pietro. Thank you.